Hare Krishna, I welcome all the devotees to Bhakti Sangha Jepa conference call. Today we are very fortunate to have Her Grace Preethi Vilasini Mataji to enlighten us on topic Sri Brihat Bhagavatamrutam. Thank you so much, Mataji. We are very fortunate to have you on the call. And today we are very, very fortunate on Ekadasi day for listening from you, Mataji. Please take over the call, Mataji.
Hare Krishna Vinaya Mataji, thank you so much, Mataji. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to all the assembled devotees. Please accept my dandavat pranams and to all of you. Om Namo Bhagavati Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavati Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavati Vasudevaya. We are continuing to see from Sri Brihat Bhagavatamrita today. And today is session number 12. Narada is now in Sutala Loka with Prahlad Maharaj. He is speaking to Prahlad Maharaj. And Prahlad Maharaj is glorifying Hanuman as being the greatest recipient of the Lord's mercy. So we'll continue to see the glories of Hanuman in today's session, and I don't think we'll be able to finish it off in the session. So we'll have some more glories that we will speak in our next session as well, and then we'll move on to Kim Purusha Loka, where Hanuman is situated. So that is the outline of the subject matter that we'll be discussing today. ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकाया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः मुखं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्गायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारिणं नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते राधानाथस्वामिनित्यनाम्ने नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनित्यनाम्ने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशकारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्त वृंद ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्रीला सनातन गोस्वामी हू दी ऑथर ऑफ श्री बृहद भागवत वंशाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः हरे कृष्ण. So, in our previous session, we discussed about how Hanuman received so many benedictions from different demigods and how he was so well-read and extremely wise and scholarly, and he was even appreciated personally by Lord Ram for his communication skills. And we saw how courageously he crossed the vast ocean in spite of the hindrances that he underwent while crossing the ocean. So we will continue from there. What happened after Hanuman reached Lanka? So this most courageous Hanuman, even though he crossed 100 yojanas, he was without a sigh and he did not feel any tiredness. So out of his humility, Hanuman was thinking, all this is because of the mercy of Lord Ramachandra. Because of the mercy of Lord Ram's holy names and the ring that he has personally given me. So that's the reason, in spite of such a great flight, I don't really feel tired. So he was thinking all this was possible only by the Lord's mercy. And that was actually the greatness of Hanuman. Hanuman's greatness was not just his strength, but actually his greatness was his humility. So when one is absorbed in the service of the Lord, what happens is the Lord empowers him and the Lord awards him with bliss in the service that he is performing. So therefore, the devotee becomes so absorbed in the service that he doesn't feel any mundane tiredness. So similarly, Hanuman was thinking, how is it that I'm not feeling so tired? And then immediately he realized, it's not that because I am Vayuputra or I am such a great Vanara that I was able to jump across the ocean. But then everything is because of the Lord's mercy, because the Lord was giving me his shelter all the time. So that's why in Bhagavad Gita 9.2 Krishna says, Susukam kartum avyayam. Devotional service is joyfully performed. So if you are performing devotional service properly, that means we'll be happy. We won't feel any mundane tiredness. So after the sun had set, Hanuman, he thought he had to reduce his size. Because the Rakshasas would become very, very alerted seeing his huge size. So for that reason, Hanuman reduced his mountain-like body to a small size, like the size of a cat. And it was such a beautiful sight to behold. So finally, Hanuman, in that particular size of a cat, he reached the actual entrance of the city of Lanka. So when he was just about to enter the main city of Lanka, that guardian of that city, her name was Lankini. Sometimes she's referred as Lanka, you know, with the extra. She's sometimes referred as Lanka, or her, we'll call her Lankini for now. So this guardian of the city of Lanka by the name Lankini was standing there. And she saw Hanuman entering this city. And when she saw this interesting monkey was trying to enter the city, she asked him, "Who are you? Why have you come here? And you cannot enter Lanka without my permission." So then Hanuman, he looked at this horrible form of this demoness. And he was like, "Who are you? Why are you stopping me?" And she said, "On the order of the great king Ravana, I am protecting Lanka." And Hanuman raised his chest and he said, "Oh, I'm visiting Lanka and I just wish to see the beauty of Lanka. I'm just a visitor. I want to come and go around. I just want to see Lanka's beautiful gardens, parks, forests and all the important houses around, all the palaces that are here. I've heard about Lanka's beauty, so I'm here for sightseeing." So then Lankini screamed and she said, "You're such a lowly monkey. You just cannot enter like that. This is a city guarded by me and I don't give you any permission to enter." So then Hanuman told her, "Just let me go in and I'll be back very soon. I'm only here for sightseeing. I'm just going to see Lanka's beauty. I'm going to return back. That's all." And then Hanuman, when he said this, Lankini got very irritated and she raised her palms and she slapped Hanuman. She gave him one slap. So when Hanuman was slapped like this by Lankini, Hanuman felt initially a little dizzy, but then he got very angry. So he folded the fingers of his left hand and he made a tight fist and he slapped her with that. So he's like, "You slap me, I slap you back." So then he thought for one second, "What did I do? She's a woman. Why did I slap her so hard? Actually, that Rakshasi, she fell on the land and she fainted for a few minutes because of the strength of Hanuman." So seeing her condition like that, Hanuman, he felt very bad and he started showing kindness towards her. And as she woke up, suddenly Lankini remembered something that had happened to her in the past. After remembering that, Lankini very happily, with a faltering voice, without any pride, she told Hanuman, "Oh Vanara, oh monkey, in earlier times I was told by Lord Brahma, once a monkey defeats you by his strength, that time marks your destruction. It will also denote the end of your King Ravana. So monkey, today I have been beaten up by you, so I understand that our King Ravana is going to be destroyed and Lanka will also be destroyed. Monkey, you have my permission. I understand that the end is nearing. So now you can enter Lanka, you can go and you can execute your task." So like this, after defeating Lankini, Hanuman, finally he entered the city of Lanka with his left foot. So when entering the city of enemies, one who wishes their destruction usually places their left foot first into the city. But however, if you're desiring the well-being of any place, you enter with your right feet. Entering with your right feet is considered auspicious. That's why traditionally in Indian families, usually when the girl is newly wed, she's asked to enter her in-law's house with a right foot so that the house becomes auspicious and she desires the well-being of that place. So Hanuman entered with his left foot, desiring to destroy the entire Lanka. Now, Sita was in Ashokavan. So Hanuman, this is a long story. He went on searching for Sita in many places. And after a very long search, he realized that he had not searched Ashoka Vatika. That is where Sita was kept. So he saw Ashoka Vatika and he entered that grove, and there he actually saw Mother Sita. He sat on a particular tree called as a Simshupa tree, and Hanuman saw Sita wearing soiled garments, surrounded by Rakshasi women, emaciated completely due to her fasting, and she was looking extremely miserable. So right after dawn that particular day, Ravana appeared there in Ashokavan and he threatened Sita. He gave Sita 2 months' time and told that she must give in to his desires, otherwise he will cook her and eat her up for breakfast. So Hanuman, he was sitting on the tree and he was watching all this. But he was very, very wise. Even at this point, he did not jump and attack Ravana. Nor did he get overwhelmed by seeing Ravana's strength and stature. So he was very, very cautious of each and every move that he made. He had a perfect plan in mind. He decided to see Sita only when no one noticed, so that this entire effort of crossing the ocean, coming and seeing Sita and going back and giving information to Ram is not gone wasted. If he reacts, you know, without thinking, he knows very well that he'll mess up everything. So after Ravana's threatening and Sita refusing to give in to Ravana, Ravana left that place. But then Hanuman sat on the tree and he watched the entire drama very silently. So meanwhile, Sita, who was tortured like this by Ravana and who was given this 2 month time limit, she felt horrible. She felt it's better to suicide than be killed by him or to go and satisfy his desires. So like that, after lamenting for some time, she tried to strangle herself to death with the braid of her hair. So she tied the braid of her hair to the tree and she was trying to strangle herself. So while she tried to tie the hair around her neck, Sita started feeling some good omens on her body. So her left eye, her left hand, her left thigh, all this began to quiver. And a very lovely bird sat up on the tree and began chirping sweetly as if Ramchandra was present there and giving her comfort. So seeing all these good omens, Sita's heart actually started becoming a little delighted. Now all this while, Hanuman was sitting on the Simshupa tree and his heart was beating really fast. He was so tense that Sita would do something to herself. And he was in a dilemma what to do now. He was thinking, if he did not act even now, and if he doesn't console Sita now, Sita would give up her life. At the same time, he was thinking how to talk to her. He had taken the form of a small monkey, and this monkey was the size of a small cat. He was thinking, if I speak in the language of a monkey, if I just say, ke, she will not understand anything. And if I go and stand in front of her in my original form as Hanuman, she may even faint seeing me. If I go and begin to talk in Sanskrit, in the small form, she'll be totally shocked. She'll be thinking, how can a monkey like this talk Sanskrit, right? So he thought she may even suspect that it is Ravana who's trying to fool around with her. And he was thinking she may scream out. She may alert all the Rakshasas. So Hanuman was thinking, what to do now? I have to take some action. I have to save her. But what do I do? At that time, just like how a medicine at the right time can save a person who's about to die, similarly, Hanuman decided to employ the right medicine during a very crucial situation. And what is this right medicine? The medicine that can relieve us even from this vicious cycle of birth and death. That is the holy names of Lord Ram. So Hanuman was thinking, how can Sita hear my words without fear? Like this, this wise Hanuman, he made up his mind. He thought, if I glorify Rama, if I speak about his wonderful qualities, if I chant his holy names in a very sweet voice, she will listen to it with attention. Her mind will become absorbed in his thoughts and somehow I can save her. So he knew very well, if he speaks about the glories of Ram, if he speaks about Ram, his glories, his holy names, Sita's attention can be captured and her mind will be diverted and he can stop her from suicide. So thinking like that, Hanuman began narrating Ram Katha in very sweet words within the hearing range of Sita, so that only Sita could hear. So he began saying, once there was a king by the name Dasharath. He was very, very glorious among all the kings of the Ikshvaku dynasty. Instigated by Dasharath and Dasharath's wife Kaikeyi, the stepmother of Ram. Ram, who was the eldest son of Dasharath, went to the forest along with his wife and brother. Lord Ram killed many demons in the forest. Thereafter, hearing about the killing of the demons in Janasthan, killing of Karadushana, Ravana was very enraged and he took away Sita by deceiving Ram and creating an illusory image of a deer in the forest. So like this, he began talking about the story of how Ram, Sita and Lakshman had come to the forest and Sita was kidnapped by Ravana. So till this point, Sita knew the story because she was also a part of the story. She knew what happened. She didn't know the rest of what had happened. So Hanuman continued. He continued the rest of the story of Lord Ram. And at this time, Sita listened to it even more attentively because she didn't know what happened after that, right? So she was listening even more attentively. He said, searching for Sita, that glorious Ram met a Vanara by the name Sugriva. He befriended the Sugriva in the forest and he killed Vali and gave the kingdom of the Vanaras to Sugriva. As commanded and sent by Sugriva, thousands of Vanaras are searching for that lady Sita in all quarters of the world. By the words of Sampati, I, Hanuman, a very swift Vanara, the son of Vayu, crossed the ocean for the sake of this broad-eyed Sita. This Sita has now been found by me, and she is the same Sita with all auspicious qualities, perfect complexion and the bodily marks as I heard from Lord Ram. So like this he said these words and Hanuman kept quiet. Now at this point Hanuman successfully executed his plan. He wanted to stop Sita from suicide. So he began narrating Ram Katha. Now Sita Devi, she was so stunned hearing this beautiful Ram Katha. And she was completely absorbed in hearing Hanuman's words. Hearing all this, she became very, very delighted and she looked around. She looked up at the sky to see if the Lord himself was consoling her. She looked down at the earth to see if her mother, Mother Earth, was telling her the story. She looked around and then finally she looked at the Simshipa tree where Hanuman was sitting. Now, at this time, Sita saw this most intelligent and radiant son of Vayu, Hanuman, sitting there on the branches of this tree. So this was the first time Hanuman was blessed with the sidelong glance of Mother Sita. And he was, from then on, so many things changed in Hanuman's life because he was blessed by the sidelong glance of Sita Devi for the first time. So that Hanuman, with a very humble demeanor, he got down and he approached Sita and he offered his obeisances. And keeping a joint palms on the on top of his head, he spoke to Sita telling, "Oh beautiful lady, your eyes resemble lotus petals and based on the marks on your body and other characteristics, I'm sure you must be a queen and you must be the daughter of a king. So if at all you are Sita, who was stolen by force by Ravana from Janasthan, tell it to me, I have to know." So he said, "According to your miserable state and your superhuman beautiful qualities and features and your clothes, which is all torn and endowed with austerity, you must be Rama's wife." So hearing these words, Sita was so delighted when she heard Ram, when she heard the name Ram. Then she introduced herself. She said, "I'm the daughter-in-law of Dasharath and the daughter of King Janaka." So when she said that, Hanuman was relieved. She said, "Ravana had kidnapped me when I was in the Dandakaranya forest. And now this evil Ravana has given me 2 months' time before which he has asked me to surrender to his desire. But it is better if I give up my life." So when Hanuman heard these words from Sita, he said, O Sita Vaidehi, I have come here as Ram's messenger on Ram's directions. Lord Ram is always thinking of you, so don't worry. So when he said like this, Sita became very, very happy. So after some conversation, Hanuman gave Sita the ring that was sent by Ram through him in order to strengthen her confidence. And later, Sita also, she received the ring. When she received the ring, she felt the very warm embrace of Lord Sri Ramachandra. She begged Hanuman again and again to arrange for Ram's arrival to Lanka and to meet her within 2 months, before the time limit that was given by Ravana for her survival. So then Hanuman consoled Sita and told her that Ram will surely come. At that time, Hanuman, he offered to carry Sita on his back to Lord Ramchandra. So when Hanuman made this offer, looking at the small size of Hanuman's body, Sita said, you are so small, how are you going to carry me? So then Hanuman told, no, this is not my original form, I am Vayupatra, I can show you how big I am. And then he assumed a big gigantic form to inspire confidence in Sita. But then, however, Sita said it was not possible for her to go with him. So she started giving various reasons. So first she said, I will not touch another man. I will not touch another man, sit on him and go. That's not going to happen. So one may say that this doesn't sound like a good reason, because Sita is Jagan Mata. She is the mother of the entire universe. And Hanuman is the son of Sita, right? So this reason that Sita gave was not very convincing. Then Sita gave another reason. She said, if you're crossing the ocean with me, Ravana is not going to keep quiet. You think Ravana will sit back and watch? He will send his forces and you will have to put me down to fight with him. And when you're crossing, you know, the ocean, you have to put me in the ocean. Just think about it. This is not going to work out. But again, this was not a good reason, because we all know Hanuman was capable of fighting hundreds and thousands of Rakshasas even without putting down Sita in the middle of the ocean. Then Sita said, seeing the vastness of ocean beneath me, what if I faint and fall down into the ocean? What will you do then? Even now Hanuman was not convinced, because he knew Sita was no ordinary woman, and she was the daughter of Janaka and she was the wife of Ram, the daughter-in-law of Dasharath, such a great Kshatriya woman. Sita will not be so fearful. So then finally Sita gave the reason that Lord Ramachandra is my husband. He must come and rescue me. It will not be nice to say that a Rakshasa kidnapped Mother Sita and a monkey went and rescued her. No, Ramachandra is the greatest of all men, and only he should come to take back his wife. It will be befitting for Ram's glory only if he comes personally to rescue his wife. Like that, Sita declined to go with him, and very lovingly she requested Hanuman to bring back her husband to Lanka. So Hanuman was very satisfied with the way she spoke, and when he heard all these beautiful words from Sita, and he said, your words are so filled with humility and chastity to your husband, so definitely whatever you said is correct. He will bring Ram and Ram will rescue you. Like this, after Prahlad Maharaj spoke about the wisdom of Hanuman and how excellently he spoke to Sita Devi and convinced her, next Prahlad described about how Hanuman threatened the demons and broke the forts and burned down the city of Lanka before he returned to Ram. So keep in mind, this is still a conversation of Prahlad Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj glorifying Hanuman to Narada. So we are going to the next stage of the glorification of Prahlad Maharaj. So after this, after what all Hanuman did, after his meeting with Sita, he just didn't leave like that. He thought, I need to meet Ravana. I need to go and assess his strength. I need to see the strength of all the Rakshasas. Only then I can leave Lanka. So Hanuman had accomplished his mission, actually. He found Sita. But he wanted to do something more. He thought, this excellent Ashoka grove belongs to this cruel Ravana. It's so beautiful. It's just like the Nandana gardens of Indra. But I will destroy this Ashoka grove and I will provoke Ravana. When this grove gets demolished, Ravana will become angry and there will be a big fight. I can go get an audience of Ravana, I can see his strength and I can see the strength of all the Rakshasas. So Hanuman, he started to throw away many trees with a violent jerk. He damaged the trees, he damaged the creepers, he damaged the ponds, he broke the hills there. He did all this. And seeing the devastation that was caused to this Ashokavan by Hanuman, all the female demonesses there, they went and asked Sita first, who is this monkey? Why did you talk to him? What is he doing now? When they went and asked Sita like this, Sita said, I don't know anything about him. And you have to find out. I don't know anything about him. I don't know who he is. So some of the female demons, they went to Ravana and they reported to him that Ashokavan was destroyed by a monkey, and that monkey actually went to Sita and talked to her earlier before the destruction. So they told her that in fact when they went and questioned Sita, that Sita expressed ignorance about him. They told Ravana, Sita told us, how do I know? Seeing him, even I'm so frightened. He must also be a demon like you. Only you know what kind of forms demons take. Only you alone can recognize a demon. Only a serpent will recognize the feet of another serpent. This is what Sita told us. She said she doesn't know him. But then, except the area around Sita, this monkey has gone and destroyed everything. We are very suspicious, Ravana. You have to find out what is happening. So like this, all the demonesses, they went and they reported to Ravana. Then Ravana got angry and he sent some demons called as Kinkaras to catch hold of Hanuman. 80,000 horrible looking Kinkaras rushed towards Hanuman to catch him, and they all attacked him with their deadly weapons. So seeing them, Hanuman said, who do you think I am? I am the servant of Lord Ram. Even 1,000 of Ravanas are not equal to me. And surrounded on all sides by these strong demons, Hanuman, he pulled apart a huge iron bar from a gate and he began to attack all these demons. So he killed all the demons. However, some of them escaped from that place and they went and informed Ravana that all the Kinkaras are dead. So after killing the Kinkaras, Hanuman thought, this grove was, Ashokavan is destroyed by me. But however, the citadel, the fortress of the guardian deity of the demon, that has not yet been destroyed. So I will go and destroy that also. So thinking like that, Hanuman went there. And after killing the guards who was posted there, Hanuman assumed a huge gigantic form and he uplifted a pillar and he whirled it around and he burnt the palatial building, the citadel, by producing a huge fire that was created out of friction between other pillars. And he proclaimed, now Lanka is doomed. You want to have enmity with Ram and Sugriva? This is your end. Then when Ravana heard all this news, he sent Jambumali, the son of Prahashta. He was one of the ministers. He sent Jambumali to capture Hanuman. Jambumali attacked Hanuman with all his arrows and Hanuman threw a big tree towards Jambumali and Jambumali was killed. Next he sent the 7 sons of Prahashta surrounded by a huge army and they all went and attacked Hanuman. But then Hanuman crushed all the enemies using the palms, his feet, fists, nails, chest, his thighs, only these were his weapons. He didn't have any other weapons, but then he killed all of them. So after killing all these demons, Hanuman climbed up to the arch doorway and he took position. Then Ravana sent Virupaksha, Yupaksha, Durdara, Pragasha, Bhaskarana. These were the 5 most important army generals of Ravana. He sent them to capture Hanuman. And Hanuman Ravana ordered all these demons to catch Hanuman alive. So that was the idea. They didn't want him to kill Hanuman, but rather Ravana's idea was to capture Hanuman alive. So first Hanuman killed Durdara, then he killed Virupaksha, then Yupaksha, and finally he killed Pragasha and Bhaskarana. So he killed all of them one after the other. And after destroying the entire army along with horses, elephants and chariots, he went back to the door, to the arched door of the Ashoka grove and he sat on it. Now Ravana, after sending all these people, he sent his son Akshakumar. He sent his own son to fight against Hanuman. So, Aksha, along with his army, elephants and horses, he approached Hanuman and incited him to a battle by discharging sharp arrows. And Hanuman quickly smashed Aksha, his chariot and his horses, and he killed him also. So now Ravana's son was killed. So Ravana was very, very upset about the son's death. So then he thought, I don't have any choice, but now I have to call Indrajit. Now Indrajit is his other son. Ravana asked Indrajit to go and fight with Hanuman. He told Indrajit that you have the Brahmastra weapon. You have got this from Brahma. Not only that, you are very intelligent. You can easily win. So you go and capture this monkey who's disturbing everybody. So Indrajit, he said, okay. And he took a very colorful bow and he quickly went in the chariot to go and face Hanuman in a combat. So the arrows discharged by Indrajit were actually made ineffective by Hanuman through his peculiar skill of maneuvering them, just like how the wind god can maneuver anything, right? So being the son of the wind god, he was maneuvering all the arrows. And this went on for some time, and Indrajit understood this Hanuman is very difficult to tackle. So Hanuman finally used his Indrajit finally used his Brahmastra and he captured Hanuman. Now we all know Brahmastra cannot do anything to Hanuman because Hanuman already got a boon during his childhood from Brahma that Brahmastra will not do anything to him. So when Brahmastra was released on Hanuman to capture him, Hanuman, being very respectful of the Brahmastra, because it was the personal weapon of Brahma obeying its command, he agreed to be bound by the Brahmastra and he acted as if he was being arrested so that he could get an audience with Ravana. So while Hanuman was fighting like this with so many of them, and when he was getting arrested, at the back of his mind, all that he wanted to do was to go and get the audience of Ravana so that he could gauge Ravana's strength and he could decide what to do, how to face the battle in the future. So that was running in the mind of Hanuman all the time. Now Brahmastra had tied up Hanuman. However, what happened meanwhile was some of the dull-headed demons around Hanuman, they thought this monkey is very strong. He may even break away from this Brahmastra and he'll go away. So just to make sure, let us tie him with ropes and tree twigs to make sure that he doesn't go anywhere. So they started pulling out tree twigs and ropes and they started binding him again. Now, this was surely not a good idea. Indrajit, first initially he didn't notice what was happening. But then when Indrajit turned around and looked at what had happened, these stupid demons, they were trying to bind Hanuman again with ropes, Indrajit became very upset. Because he knew that if one is tied with Brahmastra and also tied with other ropes, the Brahmastra will release itself. So the Brahmastra will not stay effective if you try to bind a person first with the Brahmastra, then with other ropes also. Because the Brahmastra has a lot of self-respect, just like Krishna. Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, Sarva dharman parityaja mamekam sharanam vraja. Surrender only unto me, I will protect you. If we are not confident of Krishna that he will protect us, and if we go around asking all the demigods, you protect me, you protect me, you protect me, Krishna will say, okay, you do whatever you want, I will not disturb you. So when we must surrender completely. We must surrender with complete faith. Then Krishna will protect. So even Brahmastra was like that. If you think Brahmastra is not going to tie up and for extra safety you go and put around ropes, Brahmastra will release itself. So Indrajit knew the secret of the Brahmastra and he understood Brahmastra has now gone ineffective. And he also saw how Hanuman was acting like as if he was being tied up with these, you know, little ropes and twigs. Anyway, Indrajit, his idea in mind was also that Ravana had told him to bring this monkey in capture. So that is all Indrajit was worried about. And Hanuman was also yielding to their operation of capture, though he was capable of aborting everything because he was eager to meet Ravana. So like this, Hanuman went to Ravana's assembly. So when Hanuman was interrogated by all these demons, Hanuman said to Ravana, see, it's very difficult to get your audience. I wanted to see you and get your attention, so I destroyed the gardens. Then all these demons came and they fought with me. Just to protect myself, I had to attack all of them in the battle. Then Hanuman said, he began to introduce himself. He said, look, I am the minister of Sugriva. And Hanuman pointed out to Ravana and told him that if he really wished to survive, he should give back Sita to Ram and he should be prepared for the worst if he doesn't give back Sita. So hearing all these words of Hanuman, Ravana became very angry and he told, okay, you're talking too much, you must be killed. Ravana ordered for the killing of Hanuman. At that time, we all know, Vibhishan, he heard this order and he told his brother, no, killing a messenger is a very bad idea. It is forbidden in all scriptures. So then Ravana said, okay, I agree. We won't kill him, but we will punish him. So it is said that the tail of a monkey is the most beloved ornament of a monkey. So let his tail be burnt immediately and let him go around with the burnt tail. So at that time, Ravana ordered all the entourage to light fire on the tail of Hanuman and told them that this monkey should be carried around with his burning tail around the city and all its crossroads. So the demons became very happy. They started wrapping his tail with cotton cloth and they sprinkled some oil and they set it to fire. Now Hanuman's tail was burning. His face was looking like the sun. His mind was filled with anger and he was very, very impatient with his burning tail. So he went around the city. He began to inspect the city and its forts. He thought to himself, I have been tied by these demons. Actually, I can fly up and kill all of them. I am adequate enough to kill all these demons. However, my job here is not yet over. That's why I am putting up with this. Previously, I saw Lanka in the dark of night. Now, I must observe it in daytime. I must see all the details. I must see the strength of Ravana's associates. I must see how the city is. I must check out all the fortifications. Everything about Lanka must be observed by me. So then I will finish my task somehow. I will see that even in this condition, I go and I inspect the entire city. So this is again something that Hanuman was thinking. We see that even in this condition, all that Hanuman wanted to do was to serve the Lord, and that is bhakti. Even under such challenging circumstances, Hanuman always thought, how best can I serve the Lord? That soul was there in his mind. His tail was burning. But this is what was running in the mind of Hanuman. So accompanied by all these demons, Hanuman went very happily and he roamed around in this great city of Lanka. He saw all the streets, all the forts, and he saw where the demons' palaces are. He looked at everything. And then, what did Hanuman do? Hanuman, he went and he started burning down the entire city of Lanka with his ignited tail as a further service to Lord Sri Ram. So meanwhile, there was a demoness who saw what had happened and she went and reported to Sita and Ashokavan saying that monkey who had come and had a conversation with you, he's been taken around in the city with an ignited tail. So when Sita heard this news, she felt very miserable. She thought that monkey came to help me. Now he is being punished. She felt miserable. She felt the same anguish and same sorrow that she felt when she was carried away by Ravana. So then Sita, she offered a very beautiful prayer to the fire god, asking the fire god to be cool to Hanuman. So she said, if at all I've done any service to my husband, if at all I've performed any penance, if at all I'm a faithful wife, oh Agnidev, please be cool to Hanuman. So when she prayed like this, the fire god heard that, and even the wind god, Hanuman's father, both of them, they cooperated and they made sure that Hanuman's tail was kept cool. So they swept coolly like Hanuman was feeling that there was a snowball on his tail. That's how he was feeling because of the prayers of Sita Devi. So the fire god and the wind god together, they began giving a nice cool effect for Hanuman. Though his tail was in flames, Hanuman was thinking, "What is this? I have fire on my tail. It's blazing on all sides. But why am I not feeling the burn? What is happening to me? I feel like I'm having a snowball on my tail," Hanuman was thinking. So anyway, he accomplished his task. He went around, he burned the entire city of Lanka, and he finally went to the ocean and cooled off his tail and put off the fire. So that is how Hanuman was. Even that time, actually, he was thinking, when this fire was burning his tail and he was feeling sudden coolness, he was thinking, this must be Sita's mercy. He didn't think, wow, this is magic. I am so great. So another fire god has given me mercy. No, he didn't think like that. He thought, no, it is because of Sita's mercy. Sita is very powerful. She has prayed for me. So therefore, my tail is not burning. That is the mood he had throughout. Though he was using his anger in the service of the Lord, he was completely fixed up in the right consciousness. Even under very disturbing situations, he was trying to serve. Even when he was punished, he was completely determined. And of course, he was showered mercy by the Lord, by Lord Sri Ram and Sita Devi, both of them. So like this, finally Hanuman put off the fire in his tail and he went on. But what happened was, meanwhile, Hanuman thought that this entire city is now burning in fire. So is Sita safe? That is the thought that he had. So he went back to check on Sita. So he went back to the Ashoka Grove and he saw that Sita was fine. He paid his obeisances to Sita, and Sita then told Hanuman, "Hanuman, I saw today what all you're capable of. You, with your elevated amount of energy, you yourself can actually finish this entire battle. But then it is appropriate for Ram to come and take me with him. So go back soon and bring Ram really fast." So like this, Hanuman said, he agreed to what Sita said, and assuring her that he will bring back Ram, Hanuman took leave and he ascended a mountain. He enlarged his body and he was ready to fly across the ocean. So Hanuman completed a total of 9 tasks having come to Lanka. What are they? Valmiki says this in his Valmiki Ramayana in 2 verses. He says, 9 tasks completed by Hanuman coming were: 1. Killing the demons. 2. Revealing his identity. 3. Comforting Vaidehi. 4. Showing his prowess to all the demons. 5. Burning down the entire city of Lanka. 6. Deluding Ravana. 7. Showing his prowess to all the common people of Lanka. 8. Paying obeisances to Vaidehi. 9. Getting himself ready to go back to give the news to his master. So like this, Hanuman, he completed his task. He was ready to take off, and shouting Jai Shri Ram, he flew off onto the other side of the shore. There he met with the Vanaras, and the Vanaras all heard the news of him meeting with Sita. Keeping Angada and Hanuman in the front, all the Vanaras marched forward to go and give this news to Ramachandra. Thereafter, this humble Hanuman, he went to Ram, he offered his obeisances, he bent his head low, and he informed about his finding of Sita. So, this is how Hanuman spoke. He first began his sentence with Drishtva Devi Sita. I found Sita. This was the first words that came from the mouth of Hanuman. When these words came out from the mouth of Hanuman, Ram and Lakshman felt very, very happy. So there is something very interesting about the way Hanuman actually conveyed this message of seeing Sita. The verb comes first in the sentence that Hanuman had composed. He said Drishtva Devi Sita. If at all Hanuman had said Devi Sita Drishtva, that is, Devi Sita has been found, Ram's anxiety would have increased, thinking that something happened to Sita. So he didn't want to put Ram into anxiety, saying that Sita, what happened to her? You know, he'll get worried. So he didn't use the word Sita first. He said, saw, Sita has been seen. Drishtva, I already saw. So first the verb, he put the verb in the first, so that Ram is assured that Sita has been found. So like that, he was very careful, even in the way he was conveying the message. So Ram was so happy, he looked at Hanuman with so much great esteem. And then all the Vanaras, they asked Hanuman to explain all the occurrences in details. And Hanuman spoke about the entire incident. He gave the complete report and he also gave the Chudamani of Sita. And he told the entire story of what all had happened. So Ram was extremely happy. Ram said, such a beautiful, such an outstanding task has been done by you, Hanuman. Only three people are capable of doing such a kind of task. One is Garuda, second is the wind god, and third is you, Hanuman. Only three people in this universe can actually do such a difficult task. So he praised Hanuman like this. And then Ramachandra said, actually, Hanuman, there are three kinds of disciples or three kinds of servants. We have all heard this. We have all heard about the three kinds of disciples. We hear that Ramachandra himself says this in the Ramayana. Oh Hanuman, there are three kinds of servants. That servant to whom the master entrusts a very difficult task and who performs it with great zeal is said to be a very superior servant. One who is ready and capable but who yet does not do more than what his master asks him to do is called as a mediocre servant. One who is very well capable and able to do everything but does not carry out the order and instructions of his master is said to be the least of men. So he said, my dear Hanuman, you are the best because you did much more than just finding Sita. You went there, you assessed everything, you burned down Lanka, you showed your prowess and you came back. So like this, Ramachandra acknowledged him. And he said, I am on exile. I don't have anything with me. What do I have with me? But I have one thing. I can embrace you. Let me at least embrace you. So that is the best I can give you. So saying like that, Ramachandra, with so much joy, he clasped on to Hanuman with his arms and he embraced him tight. Ram embraced Hanuman. And what is an embrace? Putting your arms around someone that lasts only a couple of seconds. But then that embrace was a gesture of Ram to his devotee saying, I am satisfied with you. I am so pleased with you. And hereafter, I am your property. That is what Ramachandra is saying by his embrace. He's saying, I'm completely won over by you and I am your property. And for Hanuman, this jumping over the ocean, his burning of Lanka, all this was just not a show of his strength. It was all his different ways of expressing his gratitude and his love that he had for Lord Ram, and that is bhakti. So it's also interesting to see how Hanuman actually graduates from the position of a duta or a messenger to the position of a dasa or a servant. When Hanuman went to Lanka to deliver the message of Lord Ram, what did he do when he introduced himself to Sita? He said, I am a messenger of Lord Ram. But when he received the mercy of Sita Devi there in Ashokavan, when he received her sidelong glance, when he received empowerment from her and he destroyed everything, and when he came back to see Ram, by the mercy of Sita Devi, he was recognized by Ram as a dasa, as a servant. Ram said, you are the best of the servants. So actually, that is our eternal identity, to be a servant, the greatest recognition that we can get. And who recommends us? Srimati Radharani. She recommends us to Krishna. Then we are seen by Krishna as being a servant. So we may have so many services in the temple. One may be a pujari, one may be a cook, one may be a book distributor, one may be a preacher, one may be a cleaner. But all these are specific services and we don't take pride in that particular designation. Oh, I am a pujari. Oh, I am a cook. But the only realization that we have when we are serving is that we are servants. We are dasa. That is the identity. Dasa, dasi. That is the identity. So even I think in our previous session also this point was brought up by Ketida Mataji about that is our identity, being the servant. So like this, Lord Ram was so satisfied with Hanuman, gave himself to Hanuman by embracing Hanuman. So this is something that Prahlad really points out. He said he was embraced by the Lord. So summarizing the points so far, what all Prahlad had explained so far. Prahlad Maharaj pointed out that Hanuman is the best of the devotees because Hanuman is the personal associate of the Lord. He served Lord Ram unobstructed for thousands of years. Srimad Bhagavatam says 13,000 years. Point number one. Then Prahlad said he is the most powerful person. By the mercy of the demigods, he got several benedictions. He became immune to old age and death. Then Prahlad said he was fearless. He maintained great vows of celibacy. He performed auspicious deeds like jumping to Lanka. And he was expert in pacifying Sita. He successfully burnt Lanka after that. He destroyed the forts. He destroyed Lanka. He showed us power. And then he came back and he very skillfully spoke to Ram, giving Ram the message that Sita was found. And finally, he was deeply, very, very nicely, warmly embraced by Lord Ram. So these are the points that were laid down by Prahlad so far, and we have covered these points. So Prahlad explained each of these additional deeds that were done by Hanuman was more and more significant for Lord Ram to accept Hanuman as his personal associate. Now there are a few more points that Prahlad proposes, which we will finish off in our next class. Some more points, like how Hanuman actually, you know, helped carried Ram while crossing the bridge towards, towards Lanka. How Hanuman helped in the battle. How Hanuman got the Sanjeevani herb and revived Lakshmana. And all this we will discuss in our next session. And then we'll move on to Kim Purushaloka to go and get audience with Hanuman. So any questions, comments, realizations, corrections, please go ahead. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Preethi Mataji. What a wonderful class, Mataji. I was deeply immersed, Mataji. It was so nice from starting, Mataji. And I like the point where Hanuman is expressing himself, how to express himself, and you make the noise of a monkey also, and how he is trying to express the truth of the himself, and again summarizing the Valmiki's points of how Hanuman has 9 points, then again coming down to qualifications of a servant. Then lastly, summarizing also, Mataji. It is so, so nice, Mataji. I was so deeply missed. Thank you so much, Mataji, for all your hard work for giving this nectar to us, Mataji. And I just want to a little add that there are 7 immortal peoples like Hanuman, Markandeya, and again there are one more person, 7 persons.
Chiranjeevi.
Yeah, Hanuman, Markandeya, Dhruva. Just I got only 3 Mataji, that's it. But there are 7.
Yes, Mataji. Yeah. He's a Chiranjeevi. Yes.
Yes.
He's always there wherever Ram Katha is spoken. He's always there in the, you know, he's always meditating on Lord Ram. He's there everywhere.
Yes, yes. That is Mataji. As we usually do Hare Krishna Mantra, where Narada Muni is present and where Ramakatha is going on, where Hanuman is present.
Hanuman is present. Very nice. Very nice. Yes, thank you.
And lastly, have you summarized and take back to Krishna consciousness, like how Radharani is present, how the services we are doing, whatever it is, media service also, we are doing the service, whatever, irrespective of the service. So, so very talentedly narrated to the Krishna conscious Mataji. Thank you so much, Mataji. Wonderful.
Thank you for your kind words, Priya Mataji. Thank you for coming on the call, giving us your association. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. Hare Krishna, Priya Vilasini Mataji. Thank you so much for such a beautiful class. Such a beautiful class. I think for 45 minutes are left for you.
I deleted many parts. I was thinking I have written down for 12 pages. This is not going to work out, and I deleted many parts.
Oh,
But that's okay, because it's anyhow already there. You know, I picked it from the Ramayana series only. So there's nothing to be missed, yeah. So it's only a repetition. So
and also okay. I was thinking, like, quite a few things I want to mention, but you, in your class, you did it. But first is, I really like the voice you made for the monkey. That was really cute. You know, yes, it was superbly cute. And I should not say you are a missionary, but it seems like that monkey has done on the call. And I'm extremely sorry. It's a recorded conference call. I should not say you are a param, but
No, this is fun.
It was really wonderful, really wonderful. And also, you know, the next point I like that when you reminded of that we are in Brihad Bhagavatamrita, otherwise
I don't
think that the Ramayana series is going on and on and on.
I know, Ramayana.
And then what happened? I was just thinking, okay, next, and then just then you said, hey, so remember that this is what Prahlad is talking about. Oh, okay, came back. And the next thing, you know, I really like when you said that my Hanuman was feeling like a snowball.
Yeah, that's Guru Maharaj's effect that he had given for this part.
Yeah.
He's feeling like a snowball.
That's so cute. Yeah, that is so cute.
Thank you, Mataji. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Preethi. You asked me, Mataji. So such a nectar. Really blessed to have you. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Preethi Mataji. Your encouragement means a lot. Thank you. Actually, here in Chicago, it's feeling like a snowball everywhere. It's in minus. I'm like, my hands and feet, it's like Hanuman snowball, same thing.
Chicago is going to suffer more, Mataji, because I heard there is another snowstorm coming in Chicago.
Oh.
So, yeah.
Oh my God. Okay.
Yeah, it's really cold in Chicago.
Anyway, thank you so much, Kirtida Mataji. Thank you.
Thank you. Preethi Vilasini Mataji and Krishna Sunil Mataji, very wonderful, nice. Very nice.
Thank you.
I just want hearing the Sundarkand. Very wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, nice. Thank you. Thank you, Kamadaki Mataji. Thank you for your blessings.
Hare Krishna, Preethi Vilasini, Gopi, Koti Koti Dantas, Pranam, Sila Prabhupada, Sila Gurudev. You know, Mataji, you are explaining that is Lehka, it's called Lehka in Gujarati. So, the moon is Lehka is a very nice way that we just like to hear, like 14, 15 hours, but not tired. That Lehka is very nice every time I hear. And remember that Tedleka. And Mataji, you explained very nicely the story, and especially when Hanumanji is going, that time he's a messenger of God. But when he is coming, that time he's a servant. That's Dasanudas of the Sitarani story. And he destroyed everything in where Sitarani is there. And then he gets the blessing of Sitarani. Lord Rama is said that he's a Das Dasanudas. And so we have to do a bhakti, moral of the story is that we have to do a bhakti in Krishna consciousness as a Das Dasanudas very sincerely and especially for Japa. Thank you very much, Preethi Vilasini Gopi. Your Lekha is stretched to heart. I don't know what it's called in English, but it's stretched to heart.
Thank you, Mataji. Koti koti dandavats to you. Thank you. What is Lekha, by the way? I really want to know.
Kamudika Mataji, can you please explain Lekha means the lay, the rhythm.
Rhythm. Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Mataji.
There is particular word. Kamudika Mataji, please explain.
Thank you.
It's Leka is very pleasing sound.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And like you're very happy and you want to describe, but then it's you don't want to wait and you just want to just burn it out. It's so much excitement and with love, you know. So it's like that, intense feeling. It's very nice.
And
Yeah, okay, go ahead.
Mother, you go ahead.
Yeah, and it's just very sweet, like that. It's kind of, you know, it's difficult to exactly put in words. It's like a feeling, you know, sometimes you have, like, chanting and doing service, and then you become so happy, but you cannot express that happiness.
Right.
You're happy, you are very happy, but that doesn't convey the message. It's like that. Thank you.
Nice. Thank you.
Like that, it's coming from your heart. You are totally involved in the seva. So we also involved in that seva, and we also feel that seva, and that Lekha is mean, we cannot express in a word what is this, that special word.
All glories to your listening, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Vrinda Gopika Mataji, she's always very happy.
She's always very happy and she's very absorbed when she listens.
Yeah. And she also relates the points.
She doesn't miss, and then she will summarize also. She will relive the moments.
Mataji, what actually feel now, Preethi Vilasini Gopi, when you are given a lecture now from top to bottom, we are so happy, so happy.
Very cool.
Yes, nice. Maybe sometime we can also add Ramayan, like in this synopsis we are getting. But it is nice. You can retell.
What, Mataji?
The Ramayan.
I mean, you're asking for the Ramayan?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I know. Yeah, we are getting the Sundarakanda out.
Yeah.
And it will continue tomorrow, next week also, Mataji. Hanuman's glories. Because there's so much for Hanuman to say. It goes on and on.
It's very nice.
Thank you, Mataji.
I know it's a one, you know, this is perfection. Like in the serving, Hanuman is perfect.
He's the most
perfect in his life.
So true.
Thank you, Mother. And you are the most perfect in this.
No.
You know, relating on this. Very, very wonderful. And he just don't want to stop hearing. Just want to have it continuous. It's a nectar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Karmodaki Mataji. All glories to Guru Maharaj. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to Sanatan Goswami. Valmiki. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Is the bird speaking?
Bird speaking. Multiple people unmuted, so. Vinaya, say that again.
What?
Yeah,
Mataji, I was hearing Komadiki Mataji's microphone also on. Do she wants to talk anything, then I can mute it.
Okay.
No, Mataji, you can go ahead and speak.
Okay, thank you, Mataji. Mataji, very, very, very beautiful class, Mataji. It was like very nice story. I will play this to Vrinda today in the evening when she comes back. It's very beautiful. Even because I don't understand so many things, big, big philosophy and all. If somebody says me like narrate like a story, then I can easily go, I can understand. Otherwise, it is very difficult for my knowledge and I don't have any spiritual, I'm not scripture knowledge.
Oh, so, Mataji.
beautiful, Mataji. So, so beautiful. I really thank you for this. And I really like the points that you were telling, that one point, no? How this Brahmahastra, he was not believing in that and he was using the another one also. That was very nice. How much, like, you know, sometimes, like once when I was, like, my husband's PhD was going on, it was a final exam for him, and then my, you know, we were very much scared whether he's going to, it was already 8 years, we were very scared that he's going to finish or not. My mom went to the temple and asked Pujari that, like, you know, we are how to, like, how what to do. Then she told some puja to, and then she tell me, and she know that I don't want, I will not do, but she instantly told me, please do this. And then I was telling, no, if I'm praying to Krishna, why do I do this, you know? I just believe in Krishna. You said me to do something puja, I will do some same puja to Krishna, and then he's going to help me. So I was like, I remember that my mom was telling me to do, and then I said, no. And it's like, I just recollected that pastime as I like to me. It was so nice. And another thing I liked it is how Sita Mata is giving so many reasons that, you know, I don't want to come with you because, you know, you are very small, you cannot carry me. So many things. And finally she came to this thing, like, you know, if this pastime is narrated to somebody, it won't be good. If Rama is coming and taking me, that would be like this. And that point, I really, really like that point, Mataji. These two points were really nice. And another point that Vrinda Gopika Mataji was saying also, it was very nice. That when Rama, when Hanuman came, he came as a messenger, but when he went with the mercy of Sita Devi, so with the slight glances of Sita Devi, he became Dasa Anudasa. He got blessings to become as a devotee. That was really very, very nice point, Mataji. And as everybody said, that monkey sound that you have made was really, that is like you were in deep into that story. That's why, I mean, like, that's why you could do that, you know, Mataji. It was very nice. I was laughing when you were doing, actually. That's so nice, Mataji. Thank you so much. Very beautiful class.
Thank you so much, Vinaya Mataji. Thank you so much for your presence. Thank you so much for your beautiful and kind words. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Very nice class, Mataji. Amazing class. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Shyamagauri Mataji. Thank you so much for coming on the call. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dandat Pranam. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev.
Welcome, Mataji.
So nice class. Beautiful from the beginning to the end. And many things, like the first part which I liked was, you said, the sidelong glance that he was waiting for, Hanumanji receives from Sita and then gets the blessing. So therefore, something similar to, like, when we are in Krishna consciousness, we are waiting for a glance from Radharani, from the Manjiris, and again from Nityananda. You see all that because we cannot approach to Krishna directly. So that's how we have to approach that part. I like, and many, many things. I'm losing track of it. But, this was one more thing I wanted to mention. If it comes in my mind, I will tell. But
sure.
Overall, a beautiful class. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your kind words, Palika Mataji. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Any comments, questions, additions?
Mataji, I had a question. If it's okay.
Yeah.
I was just wondering, like, in the story which you were narrating, obviously this was in so much in detail, which I many details I'm not aware of. Only the broad overview is what I knew earlier. But the reason why Sita Mataji gives the reasons to Hanuman not to take her. But I would think, I was under the impression that Ram had given specific instructions to Hanuman that you just explain to her. Yeah, you can sit down. You can explain that the presence, right? And he only will come to take her, correct? So why the reasons had to be given by Sita?
was Hanuman the intention was for Hanuman to actually take her? Because
yeah, he gives that idea. He tells that now that I've come, you just sit on my back and I'll take you back. You know, you don't have to wait for those 2 months and wait for Ram to come and do all this. I'll just take you back to Ram's presence. He proposes that idea. So.
Okay. But yeah. Ram had told him to, was it according to the instructions of Ram? Ram only had said that to all, that part I didn't.
Ram specifically didn't say don't bring her or something.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, but he said go find her. So yeah. The whole idea was everyone to find Sita. First the step was to find Sita. That is what they first wanted to do.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Mataji, what is the Sanskrit word that you are telling that first year Hanuman was finding Sita, then he was telling no first year?
Grishtra Devi Sita, that's how the verse begins. So instead of saying Sita Devi, you know, I saw, instead of saying Sita Devi has been seen by me, he said, seen Sita by me. You know, he composes the sentence like that. Because he doesn't want Ram to think, supposing he began a sentence saying Sita Devi, and then, you know, he gives a pause, what will Ram think? He gets so scared, like, who are you? What happened to Sita? Is she all right? Something happened to her? So he didn't want to give all that shock to Ram. So first he says, seen Sita. I don't know what you say in Telugu.
I got it.
Yeah, because, you know, it's same thing. You know, all the vernaculars in all the Telugu, Tamil, Hindi, everywhere, you know, the sentence formation, all of them would have described the sentence formation of Hanuman in all the vernacular renditions of Ramayana. You will find this. This particular part where, you know, they don't say Sita seen, they will say seen Sita, you know, however you compose it in your language. So even in Sanskrit, it's like that. That's what I wanted to point out.
Yeah, Mataji, I got it, Mataji.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got it. And that part was really very nice. Sometimes if we are very, very much intense and we don't want it to listen so many things, we wanted to know the answer. But yeah, that's really, you know, that's the point I was completely there. You know, sometimes we have like so many things we wanted to know, and like if somebody is going to give me the answer and that person is not telling the exact answer, and then
thank you, Mata.
Is there anybody having any more questions or comments for Mata?
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thanks, Mataji. That when I am listening to this Udupi Math's Yati's lectures, they said that Hanumanji is the next Brahma after completion of this all. After inhalation, Hanuman become the next Brahma. But they didn't extend the verse which they told. I wanted to know that verse, Mataji. Is there that? If you know that.
Yeah, yes. So in the Madhva Sampradaya, Pranavayu, they say, see for them the...
Yeah, Pranavayu, they say.
Pranavayu Deva, right? So the next Brahma is actually Hanuman. I'm sure they have references to this. I have read this as well. I'm not able to pick out the reference right now. But surely there are references in different scriptures of Hanuman being the next Brahma. The Madhva's claims are correct, actually. That is correct. Whatever you're saying is correct. Pranavayadeva, yeah. He's going to become the next Hanuman. Hanuman is going to become the next Brahma. Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't know where they exactly spot out that verse and saying that.
I have to look up, Prabhu. I'm not able to send it right away because I don't know which particular... It's definitely there in the Puranas. So I can look it up and send it in the group if it's okay.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Thank you for the question. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
If there are no more questions at all, Mr. Mataji, we'd like to end the call. Is it okay, Mataji? Is there anybody having any more questions or comments?
Sure, Mataji. All glories to the assembled devotees. Thank you all so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.